advantage of this archive of webinars. All of the webinars we've offered over the last handful of years are there and free, and something that you can take and plunder from and take advantage of. Lastly, I do want to mention that we have also really, in an effort to strive to find relevance and connection to the sort of the daily existence of teachers in classrooms, we do have a teacher advisory council. I know at least one or two of our members are in our webinar tonight, and we've asked them to participate and contribute to all the different work that we do here at the center, and to really give us a chance to make this not just an aspirational process, but a very relevant and connected and practical one as well. Sometimes that includes face-to-face trainings. In a few weeks, we'll be conducting a geospatial humanities training for teachers. And we're constantly finding ways to invite teachers to the center to work with scholars, to work with technicians, to learn something new, some new tool that they can use in their classroom. And lastly, one thing I do want to mention to you is a new Humanities Moments campaign that we'll be launching this fall. We're partnering with a fine arts secondary school in Greensboro, North Carolina, to develop a K-12 school-based Humanities Moments campaign. And in this campaign, we'll be inviting students and teachers to contribute their Humanities Moment, that thing, that moment, that example, that piece of the humanities that has allowed them to sort of stitch together a better understanding of their world. And that will go into a central database, and not unlike something like StoryCorps, it'll give us all a chance to see the commonalities and the differences and the sort of beauty of the people that we all are. And I'm going to make this available to you as the fall goes on, so you can implement something similar should you choose in your classroom or in your school. So that's a sort of a setup, sort of a frame for what the Humanities Center is doing these days. Before we begin our webinar tonight, this is probably a good time to review some of the technical aspects of the presentation. Audio is going to be very important tonight. So again, please make sure that the audio is that it's legible, that you can hear it, that you're in a good place. Momentarily, we're going to be playing some songs and playing some video clips, and there may be an occasion where you have to actually turn your volume down a little bit, but I want to give you some warning that that's coming. If you have any difficulty at all, please ping either myself or Libby, Libby, who's in the participant list, and just shoot us a little private chat and let us know that something's going wrong, and we'll do our best to troubleshoot with you. I also want to make sure that you participate in the online evaluation at the end of the webinar. Once you complete this evaluation, you'll have access to your CEU certification certificate, and you can share that with your teaching portfolio or your administration to get the credit for being here and contributing. I'd say one of the most important parts of tonight's webinar will be that chat box that I've pointed out a couple of times. This is a place for you to interact, for you to ask questions, for you to pepper us, me, the facilitator, with thoughts and questions and resources that I can then weave into the conversation that Florence is going to lead. It's also a chance for you to say hi to each other and to make connections outside of your own computer screen and your own place. Pardon me one second while I. Thank you. And finally, I do want to encourage you to use that chat box. I have a feeling we're going to have to pull it back up here in a moment, and we'll do that. But when it appears, the more questions you ask and the more you can contribute, the better. We have muted all of you. The only folks who actually have audio voice tonight will be myself and our two presenters, both of whom seem to have stepped out into the hallway. Hopefully, they're going to pop back in a second. So I'm going to riff with you while they do that. It's your participation that's really going to be really key to this whole webinar process. In a moment, I'm going to welcome Florence Gore and give her a chance to. I think she's going to be logging right back in just a moment. Give her a chance to introduce herself and share a little bit of her background. Before we do that, I do want to acknowledge and share my appreciation for Libby Taylor. She's the programs coordinator here at the center, and she's really the under-the-hood webmaster of all these webinars. Right now, she's probably ducking that title since we're having a couple of technical difficulties, but believe me, Libby knows exactly how this goes, and she's behind the scenes and making sure that all this can be pulled off as seamlessly as possible. Each of you know when you're standing in front of a group of kids that that technology can cause a lot of anxiety. And I appreciate your patience as we work through this right now. Probably patience that your 8th and 11th and 12th graders might not give in the same way. I also want to mention that we have tweaked tonight's webinar in a couple of different ways, and I hope this is, will improve it and sort of speak to the content that we're going to have. Number one, we've embedded a lot of media into the presentation. We thought that it was really important to both see and hear the vibrancy of this topic rather than simply talk about it. So we will have songs and video clips that we're playing to illustrate the kinds of points that our two speakers and experts will be sharing. We've also invited, I think for the first time even, an in-service educator, a teacher, to join our lead scholar. And he is going to offer some tips and tricks on how to translate all this content into the classroom. His name is Lannis Wilson. He's an English teacher at the secondary level and the upper school headmaster at Durham Academy here in North Carolina. And he's going to offer his reflections on how to best frame and approach this topic in the classroom. And then finally, this is exciting and provocative and even edgy topic. So consider this to be a PG-13 webinar. I think we've got a couple of things that are going to have some mild language, and I'll point at that before we begin tonight to say that a couple of times we're going to put our hands over our mouth and see what happens. So, are there any questions anybody might have before we get started? And again, I'm waiting a little bit right now. There's Lannis. So Lannis, I'm going to make you the presenter. Florence, and as soon as I find, there she is. There's Florence as a presenter as well. Florence, can you speak for me so I can see that we have your audio? And what you might need to do, Florence and Lannis, both is go to the upper left-hand corner where the microphone is and enable your microphone again.
Can you hear me?
I can hear you. Thank you for coming back. I think you stepped into the Step right off stage for just a moment. Perfect. So, Florence, as an introduction, and then I'm going to allow you to go ahead and advance our slides. I do want to introduce you, and there's a bio here. There's all the work and the body of work that you've done. But what I really did to figure out how to introduce you tonight was ask some folks here at the center their impressions and sort of what they would want to say.
I'm scared.
And you shouldn't be scared. Particularly as a current fellow and an alum fellow who's been here several times in the past handful of years, but I think it's a real treat. It's a real pleasure to have a Nashville native, in fact, who's while in the midst, and I'm going to share. This is what Don shared with me, Florence. In the midst of pursuing an academic career, pursued a parallel career as a musician, and played in a variety and a various punk and rock and country bands for over 15 years. But really, the most important thing here is to go to Amazon right now. You can find copies of your wonderful book, A Novel in the Obscene, and also your album, Perfect City, in 2002. And as I did my own Google searches, the reviews were only rave. So I'm happy to point at that. Florence is currently a fellow here at the National Humanities Center and on leave from her role as Associate Professor of English and Literature at University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill, just down the road. But it's not too often that we have scholars here, literary scholars, of Florence's talents that are compared favorably to folks like Lucinda Williams and Mary Chapin Carpenter. Florence, thank you so much for being with us. I'm going to turn over the guide to you right there and ask you to lead our conversation tonight. Florence must not have liked my. There she is. Somehow, Florence, you lost your presenter. There you are back. Can you speak for us, Florence? Hello, Florence.
Hello, hello.
There you go. We got you.
Just all part of the rock and roll life, right? We get
It
all those
is. Absolutely.
technical difficulties. Sorry about that. I heard most of what you said, and it was very nice. Thank you so much.
You're very welcome.
Okay. So I thought I would just start off by kind of suggesting to all of you, and it is so much fun to see where everybody's from, although I have to say now I can't see the chat box. So Andy, if you'll just flag questions and comments for me
Will do.
that look relevant, but it's fun to see all of you and fun to see where you're from. So the goals for tonight are to have a good time, find out something about the intersections between rock and roll and literature. More specifically, I want us to think about the distinctions, the received distinctions between literary and mass culture. It's a given, right, that we think about listening to rock and roll and listening to the radio as a separate endeavor from school culture or from the high literary. And so I want to look at the history of that with you and question that distinction with you. And then I want to examine the overlapping genealogies of American fiction and music by examining the ballad form at the origin of both. And what I mean by that is simply that during the 1950s, and we're going to look at this in terms of a story by Flannery O'Connor and some history, some rock and roll history, some early vernacular music history, that as those developed in the 1950s, so during the 1950s, there's a definition of the literary that emerged, and it emerged along with rock and roll, and that's that genealogy is what I want to examine. Both make use of the ballad form, and so we'll see how that works precisely. And then we'll look at how that clarifies the relationship between O'Connor's story and rock and roll. And then we can think in a kind of broader way, something you've probably all thought about as teachers, how literary aesthetic incorporates both history and media, right? So how does history matter to an understanding of O'Connor's story? And, you know, media as a form of history, how does that come into our understanding? So, okay.
Women have heard of jalopies, you've heard the noise they make, but let me introduce my new Rocket 88. Yes, it's straight, just one way. Everybody likes my Rocket 88. Baby, we'll ride in style, moving all along.
Grandmother didn't want to go to Florida. She wanted to visit some of her connections in East Tennessee, and she was seizing at every chance to change Bailey's mind. Bailey was the son she lived with, her only boy. He was sitting on the edge of his chair at the table, bent over the orange sports section of the journal. "Now look here, Bailey," she said. "See here, read this." And she stood with one hand on her thin hip, and the other rattling the newspaper at his bald head. "Here, this fellow that calls himself the Misfit is a loose from the federal pen and headed toward Florida. And you read here what it says he did to these people. Just you read it. I wouldn't take my children in any direction with a criminal like that loose in it. I couldn't answer to my conscience if I did." Bailey didn't look up from his reading, so she wheeled around then and faced the children's mother, a young woman in slacks, whose face was as broad and innocent as a cabbage and was tied around with a green head kerchief.
All right. Again, unable to see the chat box. Andy, I'm going to rely on you to read some of these out.
Yeah, we're trying to get the chat box back up.
Okay,
oh, cool. I see it. Here it is.
All right, very good. Maybe I'll see it soon.
Just in time, you will.
Great. So just food for thought to begin. And I see the chat box. Excellent.
Yep.
Do you have observations about the sounds you've just heard? In particular, I'm interested in the contrast between Rocket 88, which is known as the first rock and roll song. There's dispute about that, as you can imagine, but a lot of people point to Rocket 88 as the first rock and roll song ever recorded by Sam Phillips. So what's the relationship between that sound and the sound of Flannery O'Connor? Do they sound different? Do they sound similar? They were recorded a couple of years apart. What do you hear in the contrast between them? And what might the differences say about the contrast between rock and literature? And, you know, it's early, so if no comments are forthcoming, that is fine.
Yeah, take some time. And again, see this chat box as a place of extemporaneous thinking. There's no right or wrong answer. But I like someone like Sue Ellen is popping in quickly. The sound keeps going out. It's only me or everyone. That's not the comment on the question itself. As you think about the song and then the reading itself, how do those two things echo each other? Looks like we've got some audio difficulties with. Yeah, no kidding.
All right.
So I mean, there's Libby. Libby is good from here. You can always try a different browser. And Florence, we'll just be patient just for a moment. I think somebody might,
Sure.
we've got multiple attendees typing in, either to complain about the audio or to give you some solid thinking. Thanks, Claudia. I agree, you know, in something that's so audio-based, it may well be the browser that you use, it may well be the microphone or the headset that you're using. Feel free, by the way, anybody to pop in and pop back out, and it might kickstart something. But to kind of pull us back to this discussion, you know, what were some observations of both the song and the reading that you heard? There's Meg. Meg is thinking deeply. Okay, Ormond's coming in. Blues chord progression and traditional Southern dialect. Key observation from Claudia. Yep. Females had no names besides a little girl.
Yep.
Melanie, of course, is just down the road here in North Carolina, so she can hear as well. Claudia, I'm wondering, you know, why that is so infuriating to you in capital letters, and I agree. But what was it that made that, you know, such a so much friction there?
Southern flavor, the picture and the language, I like that. So, right, there's definitely something about the South in rock and roll, right? Recorded in Memphis. And O'Connor's story, the classic Southern story. Rock and roll, contrast, little pink Southern dialect, good. Good, interesting. Yeah. We will definitely be talking about the South and how the South gets sort of imagined. Both in rock and roll and in the story. Yeah, the power of the beat and the music of the slow Southern female sounds of the woman's voice reading. Interestingly, that's the only reading, the only recording we have. Those people talking about cars like it. But that's the only recording of O'Connor reading a story. And one of the things I do want to talk about is the oral sound of her voice in relation to the recorded. Somebody talked about the beat of the music. All right. I will.
I'll take care of any technical questions, Florence. You can go ahead.
Shall I move forward?
Yeah.
Can do that. All right. And we'll come back to a lot of these things. All right. So what I'd like to do now is read this excerpt from A Good Man It's Hard to Find. I bet you have a lot to say about it. And actually, Claudia and female representation, we'll be coming back to that for sure when we talk about the relationship between this story and Bessie Smith. But I'll just read this quotation and maybe you can think, it's a great point, Claudia, and you can think about what you'd like to say about it and what you'd like to say about it as we learn more about the history of rock and some of these rhetorical things. The grandmother said she would tell them a story if they would keep quiet. And I love the point about the car. Yeah, that's interesting. When she told a story, she rolled her eyes and waved her head and was very dramatic. She said once when she was a maiden lady, she had been courted by a Mr. Edgar Atkins Tea Garden from Jasper, Georgia. She said he was a very good-looking man and a gentleman, and that he brought her a watermelon every Saturday afternoon with his initials cut in it, EAT. Well, one Saturday, she said, Mr. Teagarden brought the watermelon and there was nobody at home and he left it on the front porch and returned in his buggy to Jasper. But she never got the watermelon, she said, because a boy ate it when he saw the initials EAT. This story tickled John Wesley's funny bone and he giggled and giggled, but June Star didn't think it was any good. She said she wouldn't marry a man that just brought her a watermelon on Saturday. The grandmother said she would have done well to marry Mr. Teagarden because he was a gentleman, I'm sorry, a gentleman that's supposed to be, and had brought, bought Coca-Cola stock when it first came out, and that he had died only a few years ago, a very wealthy man. Okay. Now,
you know,
I didn't use the racial epithet. So I think a lot of what I'm going to talk about today has to do with race, and so I'm going to let Lannis and Andy talk about that with you guys.
Yeah, thanks, Florence. And I'm glad that you pointed that out. And you're reading this now as it was written. You're reading it to an audience of 55 folks, literally all over the country. And as all of us know, as teachers, when that kind of language that's charged and has a very particular contemporary feeling, it sometimes it's problematic in a classroom. It's difficult to sort of figure out how to handle it and how to address it. Linus Wilson is here with us tonight. He's going to chime in a couple of different places, but in this moment, I think there is a teachable moment. So we're going to eddy out for just a moment. And Linus, I wonder how you address that in your classroom.
Yes, excuse me. This is something we talked about a lot, department meetings, et cetera, as we teach Huck Finn or Toni Morrison, William Faulkner. And, I think Florence was right. She did not read the word. I know we've gone back and forth about how to deal with this at my school. Two things I know shouldn't be done. First, don't turn to your African-American students in the class and ask them how they feel about the usage or what they would like done. That just sort of puts them on the spot and doesn't make for a healthy dialogue. I also feel like you can't ignore it. So I think by leaving the space blank and then after you've read it, coming back to address why we intentionally skip that word with intentionality and why is it so charged and what does it say about this particular story? I don't think you can get away from interpreting the story without sort of dealing with the grandmother's language.
Yeah, that's a really great point. And I see some of our chat boxes starting to fill in with some equal thoughts on that. And you're right, maybe sometimes it's being intentional and it's in explaining the choices. It's explaining that that fork in the road that we make as teachers rather than just sort of doing it and then letting it pass without that conversation. I have a feeling all of you have books and literature and readings, a historical record that you analyze in class that has this issue come up. And I'd invite you to continue the conversation in the chat box, even as Florence moves forward in her talk tonight.
Yeah, I see all of you are mentioning other texts where it comes up. I think Lannis is right, is that you just cannot ignore it. And so not saying it and then returning to it seems a really good approach. And I'm sure you've all dealt with it in different ways. Yep, scarlet letter, sure. And so given what I'm about to say about race, I think the other thing to keep in mind is that if you just make it part of your lecture, I think that's a really great approach. And of course, the history of rock and roll has everything to do with it. And so I'm just going to talk to you about this right now for a little while. And I'll stop at points. And if anybody has questions, please type them in. Or you want to make a comment about what I'm saying, please type them in. And Andy, I hope you'll interrupt me and let me know that there's a comment that needs to be addressed.
Absolutely.
So, great. All right. So the historian Andre Millard has called rock and roll the most influential popular music of the 20th century. This dramatic new musical form, all right, and here's a bunch of interesting slides, emerged during the 1950s in the very years Flannery O'Connor was publishing A Good Man is Hard to Find. Rock and roll's dramatic new sound, as Miller called it, involved the transformation of America's vernacular musical forms in light of several major social, economic, and technological developments. As an argument about rock, this is not news, but I'm going to talk to you today a little bit about how O'Connor's A Good Man is Hard to Find, which she wrote at the birth of rock, emerged out of those same processes. So cultural critics have been writing on the relation between mass and high cultural forms. I'm sure you guys have seen a lot about this for a long time, really since the beginning of the 20th century, if not before. And popular music has been a frequent example of the divisions between popular and high culture. So in 1939, for example, the editor of the taste-making journal, The Partisan Review, his name is Clement Greenberg, he wrote an influential essay on this topic called Avant-Garde and Kitsch. Greenberg begins the essay musing about this very problem, and he complains. One and the same civilization, he says, produces simultaneously two such different things as a poem by T.S. Eliot and a Tin Pan Alley song, right, as if they can't exist in the same cultural universe. The apparent division between high and low culture is perhaps encapsulated most clearly in literary scholar Andreas Huysen's charge that modernist aesthetic practice exhibits inherent hostility between high and low culture. Heisen argues that modernism, so literature, high literature of modernism and the avant-garde, define themselves in relation to two cultural phenomena. He says that on the one side you have, quote, traditional bourgeois high culture, and on the other, vernacular and popular as it was increasingly transformed into modern commercial mass culture. So this is our traditional understanding between high and low culture. But an examination of Southern ballad fiction at the birth of rock, Like a Good Man is Hard to Find, clarifies that Heisen is mistaken in his claim that it was only mass culture that can be traced to vernacular forms of expression. The keepers of bourgeois high culture, it turns out, rather unapologetically and explicitly traced literature to vernacular music. That photograph there is of a Vanderbilt professor named George Pullen Jackson, who was one of the first people to discover and publish what he called white spirituals, which was shape music or sacred heart music. And so he was really good friends with other literature professors at Vanderbilt who came to define the high literary. And those guys, those keepers of the high literary, really relied on vernacular music to define the literary. So both Ike Turner, singing rock at 88, and Flannery O'Connor, writing A Good Man is Hard to Find, were making oral ballads, vernacular oral ballads, into to aesthetic material in mid-century America, right? Because, and as we'll see, Flannery O'Connor's A Good Man is Hard to Find is based on a song, a hit by Bessie Smith in 1927. So as you see there, Ike Turner, who is singing rock at 88, Flannery O'Connor just as clearly was incorporating vernacular ballads into the literary. In order to understand this overlap, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the journey through various media forms of one particular vernacular tune, the song Frankie and Johnny. Has anyone here heard Frankie and Johnny, this song? It's interesting. We will talk a bit about it. Multiple attendees. If people want to talk, yep, several versions, yep. I'm guessing you may have first heard it on the Anthology of American Folk Music from 1952, am I right? The Harry Smith, oh, and the Andy Griffith Show, isn't that awesome? I love it. My spouse told me about that, I didn't realize. Okay, so great. So this song, Frankie and Johnny, by the African-American singer Huddy Ledbetter, also known as Lead Belly, is what I want to talk about. So it's not, he did not write this song. Its writer is unknown, but he's one of the most famous recordings. So probably all of you guys have heard it. So in order to understand Frankie and Johnny, I will first read a headline for you from 1934, from a story written for the African American newspaper, the Philadelphia Independent. There it is at the top of that slide. Two-time Dixie murderer sings way to freedom, it said. On December 28, 1934, attendees of the Modern Language Association's annual meeting in Philadelphia were invited to a Friday night smoker, and you'll see a completely white crowd there, a social event listed in the program as Negro Folk Songs and Ballads, presented by John and Alan Lomax, with the assistance of, quote, a Negro minstrel from Louisiana. At a panel held the next day on popular literature, John Lomax gave the talk Comments on Negro Folk Songs, illustrated with voice and guitar by Negro convict Leadbelly of Louisiana. In 1934, that is, the African-American folk singer and twice convicted murderer Leadbelly, who is also known as the King of the 12-string guitar, came as the Negro minstrel from Louisiana to the Modern Language Association meetings in Philadelphia. That's striking, right? That this African-American folk singer sprung from prison, went to the MLA, and was brought into a completely segregated space by John Lomax to sing for a bunch of literature professors. So that's a little unusual. This you won't be that surprised by. Although, did you want to warn them that there's a little bit of touching here?
You know, I'll make this the PG-13 version. And I think as we thought about playing this clip, it was important to show that connection between past and present and more contemporary versions and allusions. So let's play it and we'll see what happens.
Fuck you all. This is the last song of the evening.
What is it?
This was written by my favorite performer. Our favorite performer, isn't it? All of ours? You like him the best?
Oh, and there's a donation basket for Kurt wants to buy Leadbelly's guitar.
Oh, yeah. This guy representing the Leadbelly estate wants to sell me Leadbelly's guitar for $500,000.
We're passing a basket, baby.
Yeah. I even asked David Geffen personally if he'd buy it for me. He wouldn't do it.
So you're not going to be surprised to hear that there are white musicians, white rock and roll musicians, who incorporated Leadbelly's music. In 1966, RCA Victor released Elvis Presley's rendition of the Leadbelly ballad Frankie and Johnny. In 1962, Bob Dylan mentions Leadbelly in the lyrics Song to Woody, one of the two originals appearing on his first album. And from all of these singers through Creedence Clearwater Revival and Led Zeppelin, all the way to the indie giants Nirvana, who we just saw singing in the Pines, a Leadbelly tune. We're well accustomed to finding the music of Leadbelly in recordings by white rock and roll artists, but the 1934 MLA is a little more surprising. What was a black singer who dropped out of school at the age of 14 to hang around in Texas juke joints doing with an entirely white group of literature scholars in a conference room in Philadelphia 30 years before the Civil Rights Act? That's an interesting problem, an interesting question. Earlier that year, Lomax had found Leadbelly in Angola State Prison serving time for murder. Lomax secured his release, hired him as a servant and driver, and they toured the U.S. They made trips to UC Berkeley, Harvard, and other colleges, and along their way, they made their stop at the MLA in Philadelphia. And it was on the basis of Lomax's recordings of Leadbelly, including of Frankie and Johnny, in the state penitentiary, that the governor of Louisiana agreed to the pardon. But it was more than Leadbelly's considerable talent that enabled the two-time Dixie murderer to sing his way to freedom. The governor's official exoneration occurred during an era in which scholars of literature were making claims about the kind of music that Leadbelly performed, in particular about the ballad form as the origin of literature itself. So guys, this is pretty striking, that while rock and roll was developing in the United States out of technological, economic, and media developments, right, and social developments, that is, as rock and roll was developing, people were making claims about the very same vernacular music as the origin of the literary. Okay, and it's interesting to see, yeah, Nirvana played the song and they exposed a new generation to Leadbelly. Yeah, and interestingly, O'Connor can introduce us to the hit by Bessie Smith. So at this moment, right, in the 30s, Leadbelly's pardon took place at a moment when, along with the high literary, the ballad form was understood as a cultural salve. And ballads were crucial, as it turns out, to an emerging project, that of repairing an increasingly technological civilization. Okay, this work was carried out by a group of scholars from the South known as the New Critics. Here's Andrew Lytle, here's Donald Davidson, Robert Penn Warren, and Cleanth Brooks were of this group. These guys were at Vanderbilt. They published a book in 1930 called I'll Take My Stand, in which they lamented the end of the Civil War because progress, Northern progress and Northern technology were taking over America. So there's too much technology, they argued. And out of this movement called the agrarian movement in the 30s at Vanderbilt grew the New Criticism. It's the most influential literary theory in the United States. Some of you have probably heard of it. And its influence was felt as early as the 30s, though it was at its height in the 1950s. The project of cultural repair, so these guys wrote textbooks that were disseminated to high school classrooms and college classrooms. They were enormously influential, in which they argued that technology and media forms of sound media were destroying culture and making people stupid, basically, and that what they should do is close read literature instead. The project of cultural repair that was undertaken by Lomax was taken up as well by these new critics, among them Andrew Lytle, who made the case for ballots just a few years before Leadbelly's appearance at the MLA, and Donaldson. So in this volume, I'll Take My Stand, which is infamous for its racist missteps, Lytle declared that Southern farmers should throw out the radio and take down the fiddle from the wall. It was a call to arms for bluegrass fans, basically. Stop listening to the radio. Throw it out. Take down the fiddle from the wall. Play acoustic live music, he said. In that same volume, we find Donald Davidson at the bottom of your screen there, decreeing that ballads and other arts preserved in what he called mountain fastness are the only salve for a nation ruined by industrialism. For Lytle, the problem was radio, but for Davidson, it was the manufacture and distribution of records that had precipitated cultural decline. So here's a quote from Davidson, lamenting the, quote, shop girl who listens to a jazz record while she rouges her lips. Davidson argued that the magnificent possibilities for distributing art became appalling opportunities for distributing bad art. Great, we can distribute art, he said, but wow, look what's happening. We're corrupting young girls with jazz. The US South is a model for changing what sound technology has destroyed, said Davidson, because the region has been rich in folk arts and is still rich in them, in ballads, country songs and dances, and in hymns and spirituals. The argument in I'll Take My Stand was restore the South to national prominence, and the shop girl can throw away phonograph and radio. She can cease listening to her records and return along with the ballads to mountain fastness. Now, we find traces of these ideas about ballads in the pages of an influential new critical tome, a book that defined the literature, defined the literary in American schools from 1930 through the 1970s and probably beyond. So this book is called Understanding Poetry. It's written by Clance Brooks and Robert Penn Warren. They're having a drink. Warren and Brooks in this volume, which was first published in 38, include poetry by John Donne as well as by William Shakespeare, T.S. Eliot, John Keats, and myriad others. But guess what else they have included in this book? When you open the table of contents, I recommend that you go to your library and get it and do it. Alongside Donne and Shakespeare, you find a sampling of ballads, among them one called Frankie and Johnny. The presence of Frankie and Johnny in Understanding Poetry is striking. It's one of the ballads Lomax recorded Leadbelly singing at Angola. All right, and with any luck, we'll be able to play the song now, yeah? Southern flavor indeed, yeah? Warren and Brooks do not credit Leadbelly, and also I should say, Warren and Brooks are from Kentucky. So Warren and Brooks don't credit Leadbelly or Lomax for Frankie and Johnny, but whether or not they knew Frankie and Johnny from Lomax's recording of Leadbelly or from some other source, it's worth noting that the same ballad captured the attention of Leadbelly, Lomax, and these gatekeepers of the high literary alike. So Warren and Brooks argue that poems like Frankie and Johnny, I'm quoting from Understanding Poetry, or Jesse James, which is the other American ballad they include in Understanding Poetry, these are narratives, they say, to be sung that sprang from unknown sources and that are transmitted by word of mouth and that may experience alteration in this process, and they are usually called ballads. Lamenting the machine-made popular arts of our time some 15 years later, Brooks complained that the pressure of the popular arts today as exerted through cheap fiction, Tin Pan Alley, the movies, the radio, and now television makes what Wordsworth faced in 1800 seem very mild indeed. Frankie and Johnny, I'm going to submit here, qualified for inclusion in understanding poetry because, according to Brooks, unlike a Tin Pan Alley song, and in stark contrast to the rock songs occupying the airwaves when Brooks launched this later complaint, it seemed to have hatched from something like mountain fastness. As a ballad thought to originate in uncorrupted space, Frankie and Johnny had been transmitted, or so it seemed, by word of mouth. The claims about the ballad as an oral form in understanding poetry appear along with an assertion that radio spoils whatever word of mouth enables. Extending Lytle's call 8 years earlier to throw it out, Warren and Brooks argue that radio interrupts poetic experience. We like a poem, they proclaim, not because this gives us satisfaction of our curiosity or because it gives us an idea we can carry away with us, but because the poem itself is an experience. All right, so here, I'm going to go back to that one. This is what they argue in their argument against radio, what they say. We can illustrate by comparison to a football game. If a person listens to a radio report of a game, he may really have more accurate information about it than if he were present. And when the game is over, he will know the exact score. But if he has his choice, he will probably take the trouble and spend the money to go to the game itself. He does this because the game is a richer experience. The score and the statistics of the game come to him if he watches it, not as bare facts, but in terms of action. Radio provides accurate information that we can carry away. Poetry creates experience. All right, so they modulate, Warren and Brooks here, from football game to poem, and they present the ballad as the example par excellence of poetic experience. If we like it at all, they explain, we like it because of its particular nature as experience. So in other words, radio is bad because it takes away, that's right, Alma Garcia, you lose authenticity and accuracy. If you have a radio, they think, you don't get the experience of the poem. And so what we're going to interrogate here is a little bit is this idea of authenticity. So to elaborate their idea, Warren Brooks turned to Frankie and Johnny, explaining that knowing the facts of this ballad is not the point. And I'm quoting, the mere fact that as a fact that a woman in the slums shot her sweetheart Johnny is of little interest to us. Rather, they argue, if we enjoy hearing Frankie and Johnny sung, we do so because of something more than the statistical importance of the subject. The opposing of poetic experience to radio here suggests that the more to which they refer is the presence of an unmediated singing body, that it is the physical enjoyment, and this is the authenticity that Alma's referring to, right? The physical enjoyment of a singer's voice in the listener's ear is the thing that can't be carried away as radio carries away. So mountain fastness is destroyed by radio. The sensory pleasure associated with live music indicates that both geographic and bodily boundaries are intact. The singing balladeer in the mountain thus hovers as a rhetorical image of bodily wholeness in the new critical claim that literary experience can save us from mass culture. So what I'm suggesting is that the idea of the balladeer and the idea of the authentic body of the balladeer, the live performer, is the thing that grounds literature as that which can save us from technology. And so as for the new critics, so for Lomax, artistic integrity was guaranteed by this bodily integrity in word of mouth transition. So what I'm going to argue now is that these assertions about bodily integrity and bodily wholeness as foundational to the literary, the idea of literature, had a racial component. That is, the preference for ballads over radio entailed an idea that race was an essential bodily feature, that blackness or whiteness springs forth naturally from bodies. O'Connor's story, I think, in the passage that we started with, troubles that idea, and we're going to look at that. Because Frankie and Johnny, though it is included in understanding poetry as kind of this body, you know, this ballad that's transferred by word of mouth, and though John Lomax found it, and he kind of makes claims about lead bellies having been sequestered from all media, The truth of the matter is that Frankie and Johnny was available on both paper and phonograph well before the 1934 MLA. Mediated versions of the song were available before Lomax arrived at Angola and before the publication of Understanding Poetry. Early popular versions indeed existed in print as early as 1904, and Frankie and Johnny had already emerged as a commercial sound recording when Understanding Poetry was published as well. In 1928, and you're looking at OK Records' version of Frankie here, it's called Frankie. OK Records recorded Frankie, a version by African-American farmer Mississippi John Hurt, for what they called their race series. This is the Race Records series. When OK Records found Mississippi John, they were hoping Frankie might replicate the commercial success of Mamie Smith, whose 1920 song, Crazy Blues, was touted as the first blues recording ever. So there's a rock historian, David Sweisman, who will actually be at our conference, who argues that the Smith recording heralded the possibility of a new era of African-American music. And that's what they were trying to capitalize on when they recorded Mississippi John singing Frankie. During these same years, hillbilly music, as opposed to race music, was emerging as a viable commercial market. And in 1926, Columbia Records put out another version of Frankie and Johnny, for buyers in that niche, the hillbilly niche as well. This one, a recording by the group Charlie Poole and the North Carolina Ramblers called Leaving Home, had already been launched as a hillbilly song, even before OK recorded Hurt's Frankie as a race record. So, Frankie and Johnny, there was a film in 1933, Mae West. Frankie and Johnny had thus already enjoyed a robust life in media by the time Lomax arrived at Angola to record it as a, quote, Negro folk tune, and at the moment Warren and Brooks decided to include it in Understanding Poetry. Lomax includes Frankie and Johnny in the section of his Leadbelly anthology entitled, quote, Negro Bad Men, and this designation of the ballad as essentially black brought along with it all the assumptions about ballads as word of mouth, oral expressions. But it turns out that the very idea of Frankie and Johnny as a natural bodily expression was precisely a technological effect produced and enabled by its existence as a media artifact, right? Because when it comes into Understanding Poetry and when Lomax put it in his book, their claim was, look, Leadbelly is this authentic black balladeer. And so he's, you know, in touch with nature. But in fact, it had already existed for 30 years at that point as a media artifact. And so whatever claims to black music or white music it was held up to make were in fact kind of imputed to it. As an early sound recording, Frankie and Johnny had by 1928 already undergone the cultural processes music historian Carl Hagstrom Miller called segregating sound. The construals of Frankie and Johnny as paradigmatically word of mouth by Lomax on the one hand and the New Critics on the other obscured the fact that it had already been absorbed into market niches of divided along what Hagstrom Miller calls the musical color line. Sold by 1928 on both sides of this color line as both essentially white and essentially black, Frankie and Johnny thus contradicts the idea of bodily integrity that it was taken up in these cultural domains to guarantee. All right. So, nice emojis. What has all this to do with Flannery O'Connor and A Good Man is Hard to Find? During these early years in sound recording history, Bessie Smith had a hit. Its title, none other than A Good Man is Hard to Find. And maybe we could have a little bit of Bessie singing. That's not Bessie Smith. I don't know what that was, but it was nice. Here we go. Let's see. I seem to have lost control. Let's see. I can't go back. There we go. All right. So imagine you just heard A Good Man is Hard to Find. My man is treating me mean is how it begins. This was a blues song written by the African-American composer Eddie Green. and I'm not really, it's advancing on its own, Andy. I don't know what's happening.
Okay. There you go. Where do you want to be? Right there?
Yeah.
Okay, there you go.
Thanks. This was a blues song written by the African-American composer Eddie Green. What I wanted to suggest is that, like Elvis Presley, Ike Turner, and later pioneers of rock like Bob Dylan and Nirvana, Flannery O'Connor relied on early vernacular music to create her literary aesthetic at the birth of rock. We might say that O'Connor construes fiction writing as singing in A Good Man Is Hard to Find, right? Because if you think, when if you think of, you know, My Man Is Treating Me Mean, Bessie Smith singing as a wildly popular hit in 1927, people who knew that when they read O'Connor's story would be hearing it as they sat down to read. And that's a fact that we don't think about when we're teaching it to our students, or at least I hadn't until I realized that this was this Bessie Smith hit. So by giving her story the title of a blues song, she compares fiction writing, or kind of, to singing, and stories and novels to recordings. So within O'Connor's story too, we find references to the musical title. In Pity Sing, for example, the startled cat whose errant leap from the grandmother's valise to the driver's shoulder causes the car accident that leads to the family's grisly fate. We find references to music as well in her portrayal of the killer as once having been, did you guys remember? She was a gospel singer. I've been a lot of things, lady. One of them was a gospel singer. What I want to suggest is that rather than presenting her fiction as a contrast to mass cultural forms like rock, O'Connor, in fact, created aesthetic figures in her fiction that invite us to think about her story as a version of an early rock record. Okay, now, I would love for you to take a minute and look at this passage. And if you have things to say about it in relation to all of these points about Frankie and Johnny and race, I'd love to hear them. Yeah, Undertaker, exactly.
And I can also just give you a second. Yeah, thanks, Florence. You can see that they're starting to pop in there at the bottom.
Stereotypical choice of fruit. I'll let Lannis talk about that. It is very stereotypical. It's an searingly racist image, right? The African-American child eating watermelon. What's great, though, what's really interesting is a student of mine from England didn't understand the cultural stereotype recently, and she looked it up on her computer in class. Turns out watermelon was brought from Africa. It's not an American South kind of a fruit, you know, but let's see. So sounds ballad-like. Story reads like a ballad. Interesting. Yeah, there's definitely a way that it's framed. Pat's comment is really interesting, right? It's very contained. Interesting. I like it. Take one or two more comments. Rolling her eyes and waving her head or gestures. Yes, I love that. That's a great point. There's a story by Eudora Welty called Powerhouse. It's written right around the same time. But Sue Ellen, you'll love it because there's a lot of eye rolling and it's basically a piano player, a live performance of a piano player. But you're absolutely right. That's like a kind of ecstatic musical performance. Really, really interesting. Yeah, so I think what we have here is the invocation of original expression with her hand waving, going off of Sue's point, as against mechanically reproduced expression, right? So at first glance, it looks a little bit like the comparison, right? The grandmother telling her story looks a little bit like a sort of version of her disdain for comics, right? On the other hand, her kind of desire to paint the picture of the African-American child. What I want to say is in the song, in the Bessie Smith song, a woman complains and opines, "My man is treating me mean." The grandmother likewise refers to a man with whom romantic relations do not end successfully. Edgar Atkins Teagarden, as she explains to her grandchildren, brought her a watermelon every Saturday with his initials cut in it, EAT. The story of the watermelon is familiar to anyone who has read O'Connor, yet literary scholars have so far virtually ignored its clear parallel to the blues song, which, again, Sue Ellen, thank you so much for that comment. That clearly points it out, yeah. So here, I'll just read this one section. Well, one Saturday, she said, Mr. Teagarden brought the watermelon and there was nobody home, and he left it on the front porch and returned in his buggy to Jasper. But she never got the watermelon, she said, because the boy ate it when he saw the initials EAT. Incredible passage, right? Very nice, Karen. The boy took the message literally. He read it. It lacked any symbolism. At a moment, this is the year before Brown versus Board of Education was passed, when African Americans were allowed to learn how to read in the same classrooms as white children. So that has to be relevant, absolutely. My question here, which is related to Karen's, is why do the grandmother and EAT part? Why don't they get together and marry, right? She would have done well to marry him, as she points out, because he has Coke stock. Nice contrast to the watermelon, the Coke, right? O'Connor's narrator does not offer details about their breakup, but the grandmother's laments over the dearth of good men in the rest of the story, with their gloss by the title of the Bessie Smith song, here becomes associated with Edgar. That is the good man that Bessie can't find. Also, the grandmother seems to be finding elusive. In the comparison, the story emerges as the white Southern lady's oral version of Bessie Smith's mechanically reproduced song. Just before the grandmother spins her tall tale about Edgar at Atkins Tea Garden, the narrator explains that the grandmother screwed up her mouth to entertain the baby. There's the eye rolling, as Sue points out, and there's also just all this emphasis on her mouth. The grandmother is not exactly literally a balladeer, but she's this tall tale storyteller. O'Connor's focus on her mouth draws attention to the phantom mouth of the singer whose song frames the story. So there seems to be this contrast between a real bodily mouth and a mechanical mouth. But before considering the technological aspect of the mechanism creating this relation between the mouths, as O'Connor portrays it, I want to note that the EAT story features a third crucial mouth as well, one that Karen has referred to, and that is of the African-American child. With him, the narrator creates yet another parallel that undoes any distinction between Bessie Smith's mechanical mouth and the grandmother's. In other words, that contrast, I'm arguing, between the grandmother's quote-unquote oral mouth and the hand-rolling and the apparently live performance and the mechanical one breaks down. We've seen that in understanding poetry, right? So the people I'll just mention, the people who wrote Understanding Poetry also canonized O'Connor, published the first publication of this story, A Good Man is Hard to Find, is in a book by Warren Brooks, Understanding Fiction, that I think Lannis might talk about later, right? So they gave her her career. In Understanding Poetry, literature is that which is not carried away like a radio broadcast. I'm just going to repeat from Understanding Poetry. They say, we like a poem not because it gives us an idea we can carry away with us, but because the poem itself is an experience. They like the experience. When Edgar Atkins, that's what makes it literature. Bodily experience. When Edgar Atkins Teagarden brings the watermelon to the grandmother, no meaning is carried away. The grandmother experiences the meaning of the watermelon because Edgar is there to give it to her in person. His physical presence, his bodily integrity guaranteed, it seems, by his signature, which Meg points out, or somebody pointed out, gets decimated when the child changes the word, the signature. So this is, I think, a metaphor for poetry as new critics defined it. When the African-American child eats it, however, the very same letters transform the watermelon into something that can be carried away, like radio broadcast. The African-American boy is thus associated with radio because he removes the watermelon from its original intention, from that kind of Edgar's body, his mouth. Right? So it's a scene in which I think the move from the bodily balladeer to the radio is depicted. By unmooring the word from its intention, the black child undoes the idea of a mouth as a stable bodily origin, as a mouth telling a tall tale, the grandmother's mouth. That's gone. This is O'Connor's portrayal of a technical interruption of poetic experience. This figural moment associates the African-American boy with the African-American singer who frames the story. Both disrupt the image of the bodily mouth as stable. The grandmother's oral voice becomes collapsed into the mechanical reproduced one, though. The distinction does not hold. This becomes explicit towards the end of the story. I'm going to change the slide now. And you'll remember when the grandmother suddenly finds herself parroting the misfit's philosophy. Maybe he didn't raise the dead. She suddenly becomes someone else, right? So she's saying somebody else's words here. Maybe he didn't raise the dead, the old lady mumbled, not knowing what she was saying and feeling so dizzy that she sank down in the ditch with her legs twisted under her. As she begins, almost done, as she begins to take on the murderer's voice, the misfit takes on hers, speaking, the narrator says, in a high voice. O'Connor thus ends her story with the suggestion that the gospel-singing misfit's mouth is the grandmother's. The grandmother and her singing killer exchange voices here. You see how bodily integrity is not kept up, right? It's called into question by this story. This collapse occurs in the exposure of her tall tale telling oral voice as ultimately mechanical. Alone is a new slide here for you. Alone with the misfit, the grandmother found that she had lost her voice. She wanted to tell him that he must pray. She opened and closed her mouth several times before anything came out. Finally, she found herself saying, "Jesus, Jesus," meaning Jesus will help you. But the way that she was saying it, it sounded as if she might be cursing. The word Jesus resembles the watermelon here, a word carried away from the body, a body whose voice becomes thereby lost to it. This is a figure, to return to the idea of radio, that's, you know, disembodiment, carried away. The grandmother's, that is, the thing that seems bodily, which is a voice, she just loses it and it becomes somebody else's, is what I'm saying. And so it's a figure for radio. The grandmother's orality here, also, if you look at this third sentence there, she opened and closed her mouth several times before anything came out. This orality is robotic gesture, the mechanical opening and closing of a mouth. And the grandmother's story is thus exposed as exchangeable for Bessie Smith's recording in the end. Conceptually, the grandmother seems at first to be the inverse of the blues singer's recorded voice. Smith, the sound with no mouth. The grandmother, a mouth with no sound. As sound begins to emerge from the grandmother's moving mouth, however, and as the grandmother notes its disconnection from her intentions and from her body, we recognize it as cursing and so belonging to the misfit, right? It's as if his sound is being broadcast from her mouth. The portrayal of the grandmother's mouth as moving mechanically and then emitting an alien sound figures the presence of Smith in O'Connor's story as well. O'Connor is not moving her mouth, of course, she is typing, but the sense is that Smith's disembodied singing voice emerges from this activity, right? Because there is O'Connor typing, and what's our experience of it? In some sense, it's hearing the Bessie Smith song, if we know that was what O'Connor's titling it after. So giving the short story this title construes the Southern author's supposedly more literary project as an effect, like Frankie and Johnny, of sound technology. And so just to wrap this up, I'll note briefly that O'Connor's figural work here leads to the suggestion that where the grandmother's voice is indistinguishable from Bessie Smith's, the high literary is also indistinguishable from mass cultural expression. And insofar as the gatekeepers of the high literary stake their claims of literature's superiority on the ballad as an oral form, O'Connor gave them precisely the high literary as technological media, which might be one way of describing what we have in rock. That is what I have to say. Totally interested in Lannis's comments and loved the comments as I could see them. Yeah, she becomes the miss, but I love that. Yeah.
Thank you, Florence. And as we continue with tonight's webinar for the last 20 minutes or so, yeah, really the point now, I think, is to reflect on this deeper insight and this connection between the intentionality and the tone and the tenor and the import of the way that the music and the literary devices fit together, but also begin to think about ways that you might share these same insights with your students. All of you will be standing in front of students tomorrow. All of you have, you know, kids who are trying to understand these kind of larger concepts, and your job oftentimes is to take these complications and not to make them simple, but to make them accessible. So for the end of our webinar tonight, we've invited Lattice Wilson to join us. Lattice, like you, has a full school day on his back right now. And I very much appreciate him joining us and sort of bringing this into the more practical and the realistic sense of being in the classroom, not someday, but Monday, you know, very, very soon from now. So Lattice, I'm going to turn this over to you and ask for your reflections on how to approach this kind of, not just the actual content, but the way of doing this connection and the way we might do it with younger students.
Okay, can everyone hear me?
We got you, yes.
Okay, perfect. I was very lucky to be asked by Andy and Florence to do this, and Professor Dora was kind enough to share her notes with me ahead of time and allow me to read a chapter of her unpublished book or forthcoming book. So I was able to sort of think about how I would use these ideas in the classroom. So what I'm about to sort of spill out here for you are some of the connections that I was making, and this is all the fun stuff. It's not the actual teaching, but the planning. So there's lots here to take away. Take what you see fit. I wanted to start with the new criticism. As Professor Dore explained, the story was originally published in Understanding Fiction, so it might be a good place to start with your students to go back and look at what the goal of this sort of new criticism, this close reading, is all about. And so I include this quotation here from the introduction, and I wanted to highlight a few things with the slides. The student can best be brought to an appreciation of the more broadly human values implicit in fiction by a course of study which aims at the close analytical and interpretive reading of concrete examples. It seems to us that students can best come to understand a given piece of fiction by understanding the functions of the various elements which go to make up fiction and by understanding their relationship to each other and the whole construct. What I tried to do here was sort of highlight those phrases that would begin to be a starting point for a student doing a close reading. One of the things I have encountered, though, when I do have students doing close reading, they have a hard time going between observation and analysis. And so I always like to start with an exercise where they are just doing observation. And I thought this story lended itself to sort of taking an image, the image from the story we've been looking at, the passage about the watermelon, and to have your students take an image like this and think about what it sort of what it represents, to have them to describe it without talking about the cultural baggage or the implications that go along with it. I see that Judy can't see the current slide. I'll flash back and hopefully it'll reload.
Yeah, we'll take care of that too. Thank you.
Okay. But this is it's actually an image I took myself. I spent some time carving a watermelon to say EAT so we could have something to look at. And this is where, you know, you can practice this exercise of observation. The students can describe the things they see in the image without offering the interpretation. If you hold them to that and then take the next step, so what do they see? They see a watermelon. They see the letters E, A, E carved into it, and try to keep them to the purely descriptive, but then take the next step where, well, let's talk about what are some of the significance. And it helps really unpack that sort of portion of the story that we've been looking at, where you can see, all right, now let's take that skill set we've done with this image and apply it to this short little passage. What is physically happening here in the story, and then start to unpack some of the language, some of the loaded words. We've already talked about the issue of race here, but also I love the things like she was a maiden lady. What is that? And she was being courted in this sort of language that she, in reference to herself. And I also love the fact that, you know, some of the best things about Mr. Teagarden was that he was a gentleman. He had Coca-Cola stock and he seemed to have died fairly early, which would make for an ideal that would be the very good man that is hard to find. So that's one way of starting to get into this with your students. And it's also a great sort of exercise for getting at the whole story and doing a close reading of the whole story. I did want to look at another passage because I think one of the fascinating things about this particular webinar and Professor Doar's work is this nexus between rock and roll in the story, because we're talking about Good Man Hard to Find is published in 1953, and there's so much happening in America at the time. So I this passage that came from the story, where they arrive at Red Sam's, and the mother goes to the Nickelodeon and puts a nickel in the jukebox and decides to play the Tennessee Waltz, which is not at all a rock and roll song. In fact, it's from 1950, and I think it's Patti Page, and this would have been the mother's sort of decision to play this song. So, here we go.
I was dancing with my darling to the Tennessee Waltz when an old friend I happened to see introduced her to my loved one, and while they were dancing.
Okay, that was, and you can see that's very different from the song we played at the beginning of this, Rocket 88. And unfortunately, I can't really, it's hard to read here, but this was, again, one of the things that was exciting about this, I started digging into what was going on with this music. And I looked, this is from Billboard Magazine, 1952, January 1952, and it covers the top songs from 1951. And if you look over on Jukebox Plays, number 29 down there is the Tennessee Waltz. But if you go up to number 3, and you can barely make it out, it's Rocket 88. And I love this sort of transitional moment between the generations in the story, because I think there's a lot of tension there to play with. And I think our students would really get into that. You could see that the mother was playing something that's from the year before. It's on its way down the chart, and this new music is sort of on the way up. And so I started looking at, and Professor Doar pointed out that there's some argument about whether Rocket 88 is the first rock and roll song, but there's some cool reasons to sort of talk about why that is the case. So I wanted to look at, here's Rocket 88.
I'm going to play it for you, Linus.
Okay. Okay. Can we pause that, Andy?
The noise they make, let me introduce you to my Rocket 88. Yes, it's great, just won't wait. Everybody.
Okay, that was a very different version of Rocket 88. That was actually Bill Haley and the Saddlemen. And I was, do we have the, is that a forthcoming slide or nope? I'll go back. One of the nice things to compare here is that Jackie Bretson and Ike Turner did release a version of Rocket 88 in 1951, the version we listened to earlier. And what's cool about that is you can hear this sort of broken amplifier that's sort of a signature of that song. There's a great story about they dropped the amp or something that gave it that sort of fuzzy sound that's sort of rock and roll. Later in 1951, it was Bill Haley and the Saddlemen that sort of released another version. And I think you can see some tension there that between what's happening to that song in the second version, you can hear the a much more the bull fiddle being thumped. It's a very different sound that's being played here.
You know, Lannis,
there's a tension there. Yes, Lawrence.
Could Could I just say one thing? I want to go back to the person just briefly, because what you're saying is like hearing the tension between those two songs. And then also, whoever it was at the beginning, one of the people put in the chat room that his thought was, oh, well, they're both about songs. Flannery O'Connor is talking about a car trip, and this is this kind of celebration of the rock at 88. That just strikes me as a really great observation. And it seems kind of relevant to what you're saying, because the kind of tension that you're describing between these two versions of Rocket 88, there's like the early sound recording, clunkety clunk, and then the kind of more polished Bill Haley version seemed just kind of really great.
Yes, yes. And I think one of the interesting things too is this sort of the cultural shift that's taking place between these sounds. I mean, Bill Haley and the Saddlemen probably rings a slight bell with a lot of us, because they went on to become Bill Haley and the Comets. But they were, back then, they were the sort of country and Western, what my dad likes to call both kinds of music. This idea that they became Bill Haley and the Comets, and I think, it, you know, most people wouldn't argue that Rock Around the Clock, 1954, is indeed one of the, you know, clearly rock and roll had found its voice.
Okay, you ready, Linus?
Sure. Rock away.
Bill Haley and his Comets.
1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock. 9, 10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, rock. We're gonna rock around the clock tonight. Put your glad rags on. Join me, hop.
So I think everybody, I mean, I'm certainly old enough to remember Happy Days and that the sort of 50s revival, but it's clear that what Bill Haley and the Comets were doing were bringing this rock and roll sound to a larger audience that was really going to hit its stride when Elvis came along and made what I think I'm sort of recognizing, and your students might recognize, as sort of a racial tension as well. Why re-release Rocket 88 the same year unless you're trying for a different audience, and in this case, a particularly wider audience? And that, of course, the birth of rock and roll is definitely right there at the same moment as Brown v. Board of Education. So what's cool to sort of tease out of all of this, and I think your students will buy into it, is this idea that what rock and roll is doing is actually part of this sort of historical moment where you're getting both a racial tension in place, but also a generational tension that's taking place. And so you have people like, this is Blackboard Jungle, also released in 1955. Its soundtrack was Bill Haley and the Comet doing Rock Around the Clock. And in fact, when Rock Around the Clock was released in 54, it didn't really become a big hit until 55, when it was reintroduced through Blackboard Jungle. Do we have a clip from that, Andy?
You do. Go ahead and forward one more slide.
Let's do that. Yeah, this is a great clip, and you'll see this, the teenage terror.
Listening to Rock Around the Clock. This is the theme music from MGM's sensational new picture, Blackboard Jungle. Many people said the story could not, must not, dared not be shown. The picture already has the movie and book world gasping. Blackboard Jungle deals with an explosive subject, the teenage terror in the schools. It is the frankest, the toughest, the most realistic film since On the Waterfront. It is fiction, but fiction torn from big city modern savagery.
There you go, Linus.
I love that well, I'll go back a little bit. That preview of the idea of teenage terror in the classroom that we all face every day, I guess.
It's the biggest problem in education.
Yes. But it's this moment when rock and roll is emerging and integration is happening. It's Yeah, modern savagery.
Modern savagery.
It's fascinating to see all these tensions sort of coming together. And I think our students would sort of see this nexus, as Professor Doerr had pointed out, between these emerging forms. And our students would love to sort of, yes, Jennifer, you're exactly right. Because you get that one sort of clip of Sidney Poitier, but that there's a coded language that comes along with rock and roll, you know, and even though Bill Haley and the Saddlemen tried to whiten it a little bit, there's still that the music is very much represented. And I think the next clip is Jimmy Snow, a former country singer, sort of giving this anti-rock sermon, and you can almost hear the racial coding in what he's saying.
I know what it does to you. And I know the evil feeling that you feel when you sing it. I know the lost position that you get into in the beat. Well, if you talk to the average teenager of today and you ask them what it is about music that they like, and the first thing they'll say is the beat.
And of course, anybody who teaches English literature would know that, you know, Catcher in the Rye is right there in 1951. So if you want to talk about youth culture, if you want to talk about rock and roll, if you want to talk about race in America, I think, you know, looking at A Good Man Is Hard to Find is a great way to sort of introduce them to sort of all these topics sort of coming together and having this sort of cultural influence in shaping our reading. So, you know, when you come back to your students, I like sort of end on this last image because it has all those things there. First of all, I never liked the children in this story. I think John Wesley and June Starr are two of the most annoying children in all of literature. But the idea that, you know, the grandmother, in my time, folding her thin, vain fingers, children were more respectful of their native states and their parents and everything else. So I think you're getting at this sort of cultural shift. She's still, and also in this passage, you have the racial tension. You also have that idea of a painting or a picture or an image that the grandmother wants to hold on to, sort of that fiddle on the wall versus what the children are looking at and their comic books and ignoring their grandmother. So it's a great way to sort of bring all this coding that's going on and this nexus together. And I think that's my last slide.
Yeah. It is. Thank you, Linus. You know, we've covered a whole lot of material here tonight, and I want to remind everyone that this complete webinar will be archived in full video format, but also the PowerPoint will be available, and we invite you to grab it and plunder it any way that you see fit. I think what we've tried to do through Florence and through Linus's expertise and experience is really give you a lot of sockets, a lot of places to dig into these kinds of understandings and the ways that students might make sense of these questions. We want to make sure that any final comments that you have are located in the chat box, and we'll be sure to follow up. But mostly I want to make sure that both Linus and Florence receive the full appreciation and the thanks from us to spend their time with us tonight. We hope this has been helpful and relevant. We hope that that you find ways to involve us in your own social media, that you follow us on Pinterest and Instagram and Facebook. We hope that you attend our next webinar, which will be next Tuesday, October 11th, assuming and hoping that Hurricane Matthew doesn't put us underwater here in the coming weekend. We will be talking with Peter Onuf from University of Virginia about Thomas Jefferson and his role as a leader. So thank you again for joining us tonight. Don't forget, vice presidential debate held just 2 hours north of us in Farmville, Virginia. Be sure to set your timer in about a half an hour. Be in touch, stay connected, and thank you again for joining us. Thanks, Florence. Thanks, Linus.
Thank you very much, Andy.
Thank you, guys. Yeah, thanks.
Folks, I'm going to leave the room open as you sign off, but I am going to mute myself, and we're going to start to disengage. So just go ahead and log off as you wish, and be sure to fill out the evaluation at the link provided so that you can get your certificate. Thank you. Thanks, Libby.